Thank you everyone very much for coming. And yes, I am Luke Hemmeries. I work at a company called Animal Logic, and I'd like to open by showing you a presentation in video form of the work that all the amazing artists have done over the last 25 years. We've been open 25 years as of this year, so it's a very exciting year. So please, let's roll the video.
Awesome!
Thank you very, very much. So that's the work of a lot of people over many, many years has gone into that. So I'd like to start by introducing what visual effects is. Visual effects is magic, it's illusion. In the particular way that I'm talking about it, it's the use of computers and information technology and math and physics to create images that fool audiences into thinking something is real that may not be real. Interestingly, it's one of the few jobs that if you can't see what we do, we're doing it well. The better that we do it, the more invisible it is. And I think that that's probably a testament to the Oscar award winner this year, Ex Machina, which was showing a female replacement for full CG that was so good that it was not detracting at all from the story. So that's a really good example of visual effects that's come so far that it's almost seamless. We're kind of like magicians or illusionists. We can create new things, or we can add things to existing footage to integrate them seamlessly. Some things may be impractical to shoot for real or too dangerous, and we can also assist in those situations. Yes, we do use blue and green screens, but there is a lot more to the art than that, and I'm going to do my best to explain some of those things. So, who is Animal Logic? Well, Animal Logic is a company that was started in 1991 in Sydney, and we are currently at Fox Studios. We employ somewhere between 250 to 550 people, depending on the project. And we consist of a large number of different types of people. People who are into information technology are a big component of that. We have many artists, which are also assisted by the technical people. And we're internationally recognized. We won an Academy Award for Happy Feet, the first one. And we also consist of many other disciplines, hardware specialists. We have people who specialize in the hardware of computers because we run a lot of computers. And we need a lot of management to actually make sure that everything runs very smoothly. Our job is to service directors in mostly predominantly Hollywood to give them the images and the feelings for the films that they need to tell the stories that they want to tell. And as our CEO, Zarian Albanian, says, great work requires great people. Who am I? My name is Luke Hemmeres. I'm a render technology specialist at Animal Logic. That job title basically means that I'm working on software that's used to generate images for the final films. So I'm working on things like simulating the physics of photons of light moving around a scene to try and get something that looks so realistic that you can't tell the difference between that image and real life. I began my career in a slightly interesting way. I'd always wanted to be a pilot for the longest time, but I also changed my mind quite frequently. After wanting to be a pilot, I wanted to be an electrical engineer, couldn't really make up my mind. And then my parents taped on VHS, of all things. Half the people in this room probably don't even know what VHS is. They actually taped Terminator 2, and living the sheltered life that I did, they actually cut out all of the violence, which actually makes for a very strange film in terms of the way it plays out. So I watched this film, and the thing that I couldn't get out of my head was, how did they do that liquid metal guy? I mean, seriously, at the time, it was just so incredibly mind-blowing that that was possible. I just dedicated the rest of my life to basically working in an area that could evoke such emotion in people watching. And that's kind of what brought me to it. In order to actually start my career properly, just after university, I went to Adelaide Uni and studied mathematics and computer science. I went pretty much directly into employment through a very fortuitous meeting with the head of Rising Sun Pictures in Adelaide. I'm originally from South Australia, and I started my working career there. I got an internal transfer over to Sydney after completing an internship there, which was their first ever internship, which I can probably speak to people after this about how I sort of enacted that, but I partially assisted in getting their internship program up and running. And from there, I worked with them for quite a few years, including on movies like Australia, and Superman and things like that. But the very first project I worked on for them was actually Lord of the Rings, Return of the King, which was just amazing to start there. That was just pure luck. Often it doesn't work that way. I just got very lucky. I moved from there to work at a company called Dr. D Studios, where I worked on Happy Feet 2 for a number of years. And then when that film finished production, I worked at a place called Flying Bark Studios working on the Blinky Bill movie. And then I took a short hiatus working on iOS apps because it's really important with technology these days to be across a lot of different fields, a lot of different aspects. Things change really fast. And in that particular case, I could see that iOS was an emerging field, but it didn't quite gel with me. I worked in it for a year, and it didn't quite provide the challenge that I wanted at the time. So I was called up by an ex-colleague of mine about this project called The Lego Movie. And I was like, that sounds pretty cool. I've always been into Lego. So I thought, this sounds really good. So I joined the company, and my task was to basically figure out how they were going to generate these incredibly detailed images. And the result of that is a piece of software called Glimpse, which I now work on with a team of 5 people. It's developed entirely here in Australia. And it's basically a piece of rendering software that simulates reality, simulates the way that light really moves. And it's one of the reasons why the Lego Movie, we believe, was so successful, because it really was able to fool people. In fact, I won't tell you how we did it, because to this day, I like reading the YouTube comments and seeing people arguing over whether we did it for real with stop motion or whether it was done on CG. So I'll just let you figure that out. Maybe one day when you guys come and work for us, we'll tell you. So what did we study? Well, there's a list of different courses on there, which is what I collected by walking around our research and development department and asking them what they did. Now, there's a lot of very technical courses there. There's some interesting stuff like aeronautical engineering and stuff. So a lot of what's there is more reflective of someone's ability to problem solve than exactly what we're doing. So I actually came into it through mathematics and computer science. But I really wanted to be an artist initially. I thought I wanted to be an animator. And then I tried it and realized I was pretty bad at animation. So that probably wasn't the best idea for me. And then I actually ended up just naturally moving into programming. I'd always programmed since as long as I can remember. I probably wrote my first code on an Amiga 500, if probably don't even know what that is. It's so old. And so I was very interested in it, but I didn't think that's what I wanted to do until I entered the industry. So VFX might not be a career path that anyone has considered. I mean, it's one of those things where because its predominant role is to be invisible, it's one of those things that you probably don't talk about in a film where you might not even know it's there as much. It's often the acting and the musical score and things like that that sort of people will talk about. These days, it's a bit different. Visual effects is a massive component of movies. But it is a viable, possible career opportunity in Australia, especially in Sydney. And Animalogic is one of a few companies that partake in this field. Now, what do we look for in candidates? Well, we look for a very good problem-solving ability. You must like explosions. Well, you don't necessarily have to like explosions, but it definitely helps. We also look for a very strong, particularly in the research and development department that I work in, we obviously look for people who are very good at programming computers. But I think a really important part about it is having a passion for it. If you're only going to work and that's you just can't wait to get home and then you want to do something else, it's possible that the thing that you want to do when you get home is what you should be doing during the day. So it's good to have hobbies, but I really think it's important to be very passionate about what you do. And all of the people that I work with, they're extremely passionate about their job. Also, I thought I'd point out two very important things, is that we run a biannual high school work experience program that you can follow that link to find out more about that. And we also run internships for post-high school students, which is listed there. We also have a position going at the moment if anyone uses Houdini for our effects department for a paid internship. If you want to know more about that, definitely visit the website. There's a full listing of everything there. So I'm going to quickly talk about some of the different aspects of what we do and try and explain them in a bit more depth. And one of the important analogies to start with is basically the idea that there are artists and then there are tool creators. So in the case of the part of the industry that I work in, we build tools to enable artists to do what they do best. In some ways, we kind of build paintbrushes that allow the brilliant painters to actually do their best paintings. But that's really important because without the right tools, you can't get the best results. So we spend a lot of time interfacing with artistic people, and therefore it's extremely important to have very good communication skills. So that's another really, really important aspect that you should all definitely aspire to, because as a programmer, it's often my job to talk to somebody who doesn't know or care necessarily about how it works, they just want it to work. So I spend a lot of time trying to translate from programmers to artists, and I think it's a really important thing to not forget. As the industry becomes more and more predominant in life, you need to be able to have really good communication skills to partake in it. So basically, because of all of this tool creation that we do, we really need a lot of people who are software engineers, and because of that, we're moving into things now, like not only just the film side of things, but we're also moving into iOS development, and there's obviously the fact that there's many different facets to the multimedia that's released now. And so these sort of areas, if you're into that, there's many different things that you can do with us. Effects is a subset of visual effects, and effects is talking about the, like in this particular example, Thor's hammer has got this little explosion coming out of there. That's simulating some sparks flying out. Now, the important part about doing that in movies, when we're talking about things like sparks or fire or water or all these kind of things, is that they're simulating the physics of reality. Now, physics is based on mathematics. It's inescapable. So if you want things to look real and fool the audience, they need to be based on reality and they need to be based on physics. So in my particular case, I did study some physics, which I wasn't so sure whether that was going to be particularly useful, but actually it's been really crucial when I'm writing code and working as I am to be able to take that formal background of mathematics and apply it directly. So next I'm going to talk a little bit about animation. And you can see here there's a frame from Happy Feet. And one thing you'll notice about that is that like these characters, they kind of have this bipedal sort of almost sort of human-like stature that they've got going. And in order to represent that on a computer, we use something that's similar to hand-drawn like cell animation, but also we imagine that you're going to the museum and you see the skeleton of a creature. And obviously, that skeleton defines the range of movement that that creature can have. So we actually have to build that stuff inside the computer, the skeleton of the creature. So we'll actually study anatomy, we'll go to museums and study what things look like, how the muscle actually lays on top of the bones, and then we'll actually create computer simulations to make sure that everything looks as accurate as possible. And that also involves a lot of technical people who are building tools for artists to get the results that they want. Now, I'm going to show you two animations that show these rigs, they're called rigs, these little maquette-like digital creations that we move around with the mouse, other things that the artists are using, and I'll show you what that actually looks like in practice with this animation. So this is one of the rigs from the Lego Movie, and you can see that there's these little circular colored icons that the artist can grab and drag around. And what we've encoded into the computer here through custom software is the ability to move it in a way that is restricted in some way. So obviously, we didn't want the Lego in this particular case to be flexible, so all of the joints are rigid, and they restrict what the animator is able to do. But in the next example here, where he's sliding the arm, we provide some level of squash and stretch so that we can exaggerate movements to add a bit of artistry to it. In this one here, this is how the facial animation was done. On the left-hand side, there's a 2D kind of very traditional cell-like animation interface. You can drag the curves around, move the eyebrows, move the eyes, squash things. And the listing here and the right-click menus are all customized tools that we've added to the software that we're using. In this case, it's XSI. And we are able to then give artists the ability to very quickly hit face shapes and animations that they want to do. On the right-hand side, there's a real-time 3D rendering of that that they can see as they're working, and that sort of speed of connection allows them to do what they want. And that's the type of thing that where an artist will ask for something in particular that they're after, and then we'll sit down with them and figure out what it is that they're after. So in this particular case, to get the facial animation to be fast, we created that system. Now, I'm going to show you a sequence that might bring some of these things together. I want you to watch that we're going to show you some green screens and plus some finals from The Great Gatsby. And I've cut this down to try and include the shots that I think have the most impact and show the most difference. But there's a lot of different processes that go in. There's the modeling at the start where we get the shape right. There's the surfacing where we actually get the color. There's texture painting. There's animation. Then there's rendering where we make it look real. Then there's lighting. Then there's compositing where we take the stuff that we've rendered and we composite it over the top of real footage. And the result looks a little bit like this.
I've seen the done it all, had my cake now. Diamonds, brilliant, and Bel Air.
So thank you so much for coming and seeing the presentation. I'm going to open it up to questions now. Yeah, let's go. I saw you first there. Oh, sorry, we need a microphone, yeah. Who has a mic? Leave your hand up if you've got a mic.
I myself do animation, so I was just wondering what sort of programs you used to animate.
Sure. Specifically animation or anything else?
Mostly animation is what I'm looking into at the moment.
Okay. So in the Lego film, we use a program called Softimage XSI. We also often use a program called Maya, which is Autodesk Maya. Yep.
How long does it take to make just a small clip like that?
Okay. So in the case of animation, it's probably somewhere between a few weeks and a few months. It really depends how many revisions are required. Some particular shots, maybe they're similar to other shots in the movie, so some of the work can be amortized between multiple things, and the second one is faster. But often the keyframe animation, which is done by the lead animators, would take maybe a couple of days to a couple of weeks, depending on the length of the shot. And then that would be finessed by the less senior artists to get the final result over a period of probably months, because they're working on multiple shots at the same time. So they may work on three or four shots a day, and they'll work on one, then move to the next one. And it's a constant process of iteration. So they may work on version 1, and by the time we're finished, they're up to version 100.
Hi.
Hi.
What sort of time frame would you aim to get each project in, based on how deep you do it?
Sure. Well, because we're a service provider, the deadlines and the budgets are generally set by our clients. So it's kind of up to them. I mean, we adjust the amount of time we spend on shots depending on how many there are and their relative complexity. So if we're working on a project with 100 shots, but one of them's predominantly difficult, we'll put more resources into that one. On average, most animation projects run for between 6 months and 2 years, and most live action will probably shoot for somewhere between 6 to 8 months and then be in the visual effects stage for somewhere between 8 months and a year.
What was the idea for starting Animal Logic, given that they were quite ahead of their time, being founded in the 1990s?
I think that it originally started as a company that was doing things like websites and things like that. And as the clientele kind of gave them more work, they ventured out into this kind of area of visual effects. I think time is up, so I might grab one more question.
Were there any problems in your career when you couldn't find the solution, and how did you find the solution?
Sometimes that comes down to compromise. So often I don't think that there ever is a perfectly clean solution for everything. Often you just get the solution that's as close as possible. And sometimes the things that you get hung up on, your client may not get hung up on. So often it's just a case of judging what the client wants. If it was always up to us to decide what was good enough, we'd probably never finish. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.